With pranams at the lotus feet of Bhagavan, dear brothers and sisters, we'll carry on with the next part of Sai Pearls of Wisdom. As we have been doing in the past, we'll continue the same procedure. The latest conversation we had with Bhagavan on 12th of January 2003, that will be quite interesting because it is the latest. Then we'll go to the previous sessions. Certain comments made by Bhagavan are of general interest, which will serve as a message and a guidelines for all of us. I thought of sharing them with you. The first thing he said was, whether it is sports meet or anything whatsoever, one should not depend on others. We should not hire anything from anybody. We should not employ people from anywhere. We should not deploy any agency for this purpose. You should be self-dependent. You should be self-reliant. This is what he called swashakti. Swashakti, what you mean? Self-reliance or self-dependence. This is a beautiful message for all of us, so that we'll stand on our feet, that we don't have to depend on anybody. This made me put a question. Swami, is it possible to be self-reliant throughout life? Is it possible? Is there anything wrong if I seek the help from external agency? Why not? Then Swami gave the answer. Even if some other man comes and tries to help you, it is only the spirit within you that should respond, not anything. The external agency would act as a stimulus, and the real spirit in you should respond to that stimulus. What a wonderful reply it is. This makes me understand that all people with whom we mingle, with whom we associate, would only help us to build our spirits. When we are out of our spirits, when we are out of our moods, the other people may try to say a few words by way of solace and support. But ultimately the spirit has got to be built within you. In other words, all the external agencies will kindle your spirit from within as a matter of response. This is the first point that he said. The second point, two are essentials for everyone. I may remind you, all these points have been said as a follow-up, as a sort of eco-session, I can say, of the sports meet. We had the sports meet on 11th, and on 12th Swami talks on these points, which only means sports meet is only an excuse to convey the divine message. Sports meet is only an apology to convey the divine teachings to everybody. It is in this context I am trying to share these points with you. Now, he said two are required for everybody. One is Shakti, meaning energy. The second is Samardhyam, meaning ability. Energy and ability are very essential for every individual. Then I said, Bhagavan, I have been under impression that Shakti and Samardhyam are one and the same. Can I have one of the two and still get along with it? Is it essential that we should have both? Then Bhagavan gave the example. Pointing out towards the table there, he said, to lift the table, you need Shakti, energy. You also need the ability to carry that table. How to carry? The technique to carry. The skill to carry. That is, that skill and the technique is Samardhyam, ability. While the needed energy is Shakti. Swami, what a wonderful clarification you have given us. I am under the impression that both are synonyms. That we can get along one without the other. Very good. Now I understand one is corollary to the other. One is complementary to the other. I am so glad. And Bhagavan still said, explaining further, the Samardhyam, ability or skill or the technique, he gave another example. Kalam, K-A-L-A-M. Kalam is a pen. Kavvam, K-A-V-V-A-M. Kavvam. Kavvam is an implement used to churn the butter. What do you call it? No, to churn that. You have the curd and you churn it. That is kavvam. Churner, shall I say?
Churning rod.
Churning rod? Oh, good. Thank you. Churning rod, that in English, you said it, but in Telugu we call it kavvam, K-A-V-V-A-M. Kalam is pen, K-A-L-A-M. Swami is a poet of poets. He brought these two words in a poetic way. Kalam, pen is used to write. Kavvam, churning rod, is used to churn the curd. This is ability. This is a skill. You cannot use the churning rod to write. You cannot use the pen to churn the curd. This is a skill. That's how he explained both the words, Shakti and Samarchyam, the energy and the ability. Swami, I want to know here, where does the divinity come here? If I have energy and ability, where does the divinity come here? What is the place of God here? Is it not enough if I have ability and skill? Then what is the question of God? Now Swami gave the answer. Okay. Here you have sown a seed in the soil. Seed is growing. Is germinating. How can it germinate without the soil there? Soil is the divinity, which helps the seed to germinate. Oh, Swami, I understand. But now, I want to know, with a reference to energy and ability, please explain me. Seed is only one, but I mentioned two. Shakti and Samarjam. Please explain with a reference to that. Was in a good mood? My good days are still ahead. So immediately said, you see, here is the seed that grows in a tree. What is it that joins both? Water. Water is the interlink between the roots in the soil and the shoot above the soil. Water is the interlink. Similarly, between energy Shakti and ability Samarjam, the link of water, divinity is a connection. You understand me? How nicely said. Unless there is water, you can't expect the seed to germinate. And the same water goes into the tree also. So water is the interlink between the two, the root and the shoot. Same thing applies to ability and the energy. Really very good. Then I have put another question, Swami. Somehow I feel that I cannot be at my best without others' help. You want me to be self-dependent. You want me to be self-reliant. You want me to be independent. But somehow I feel within that I cannot get along well without somebody's help. Immediately came the answer, vehemently, in clear-cut terms from Bhagavan. It is your weakness that makes you feel so. Your weakness only makes you feel that you need somebody's help. In fact, your power, your ability, your energy can manage anything on their own. To seek others' help, the feeling that you cannot manage for yourself is more or less a reflection and a sign of your own weakness. That's what Bhagavan has said. This is a clue for all of us to rely more on God, not to depend on others, which is a clear-cut sign of weakness. Am I clear, please? See the beauty, the way how he explains. Somehow, Swami, I may need somebody to encourage me at least. I don't want to leave at that point. All right, if I don't expect anything from anybody, at least I need somebody to encourage me, to say a few words by way of encouragement. Why not? Then he said, no. He used two words, utsaham. Utsaham means enthusiasm. Protsaham, encouragement. Enthusiasm and encouragement. Utsaham, protsaham. I have written all these English words, their meanings also, for your benefit. Utsaham is enthusiasm. Protsaham is encouragement. All right. Others may encourage you, but the spirit of encouragement is born within you. He is not pushing or he is not putting any encouragement into your mouth. You get yourself encouraged by his words. So encouragement is not like a tablet to be swallowed. Encouragement is not anything like an injection given to you. Ultimately, the enthusiasm has to be born, has to find its place from within, not from outside. That's what he said. So this enthusiasm, the encouragement that you should feel from within, not never from the external or outer agency, that's what he said. Then he was commenting to the other person sitting there. Did you see Anil Kumar yesterday on the stage, sports meet, suit and a necktie? Huh? Did you see him yesterday? That man, yes, Swami, it was very nice. And I told him, one elderly gentleman, the warden of the Vrindavan hostel. He said, "Swami, I told Anil Kumar on the face, you look like a sportsman with your dark blue jacket and white pant and a tie. You look like a sportsman." He was very nice. That's what he said. Then I said, "Swami, if I am not majestic here, where else can I be majestic? If I am not fully dignified here, if I am not in fullness of my grandeur, where else can I be? If I am very well dressed at my native place, at the most my people on the street may watch me. But here, I am watched by thousands and thousands of people, both from India and abroad. Why not? So I feel like to be in the best way possible, because I am by the side of God. Why not?" Then he said, "What more you want to say?" Then I said, "Swami, one word is darja. Darja meaning with all that pomp and show. The second, tini, with all the dignity. With this darja and tini, with this pomp and dignity, if I am not here, where else can I be?" Swami was watching me keenly. Then I thought, it's time to just take a chance and try to make it little lighter, because I don't want to take the risk. Then I said, "Swami, what is the difference between darja, pomp and show, TV and dignity? What is the difference? Are they one and the same?" Yes. Then Bhagavan said, "What is darja outside is reflected inside by way of TV. The pomp and show is outside, the dignity is inside. It shows up itself like that. What is all the scene shot outside is seen on the TV, television. This TV is the TV." What he said? Television, TV. You understand my point? Because the beautiful pun, you know, the literary words. So, TV, the dignity, is like a TV, which is the scene from outside shot at, what you call darja, pomp and show. Wonderful, Swami, very nice. Very nice, I am so happy. Then he called the principal of Vrindavan College, the youngest principal of the campuses, a former student of Swami's university. "How is he?" he said. "Swami is a gem of a boy." Then he said, "How do you know?" "For the simple reason, he is your product. Whereas I came here when I was 45. At the age of 45, I came to you. Half spoiled. Whereas this boy is your product, 100% pure." Good. Then Swami said, "How about me?" "Swami, you have no age. I came here at the age of 45. This boy came to you at an young age. You want me to tell how you are? You have no age. You are beyond age." Then good God gave me a beautiful smile and he said, "How do you know?" Then I said, "Swami, I know many people who told me, Swami performed my marriage, Swami performed my son's marriage, Swami named my great-grandson. We are all getting old, but Swami is same like that. So you are beyond age." "It's okay, okay, okay." But then he made a remark, which is very important. If you are also like me, you can be beyond time. Swami, like you? What do you mean by that? He said, I have no worries, chintalu. I have no worries, no chintalu, no thoughts. I have no thoughts, nothing. I have no worries, chintalu. If you have no chintalu or worries, you can also be young like me. Swami, why people become old? Worries will make you look aged. Worries are responsible for the old age. If you have no worries, you can look like me. How wonderful would it be if we are also free from the worries? The more we want to be free from the worries, we get worried more. Let the sleeping dogs lie, so that we don't have to wake them up. And then, there was a special mention yesterday. Some gentleman said, on the same day, I mean 12th, Swami, 14th happens to be Vaikuntha Ekadashi also. Not only Sankranti, another festival also coincides by name Vaikuntha Ekadashi. Vaikuntha Ekadashi is a celebration, is an occasion of worship offered to all the deities at the same time. All the deities. God is one, deities are many. Agree? There's difference between God and deity. Agreed? Lakshmi is a deity. Saraswati, deity. Durga, deity. Kali, Durga. These are all deities. But the divinity is one and the same. Am I clear? So, Vaikuntha Ekadashi is an occasion when we pray our obeisance to all the deities on the same day. Vaikuntha has a meaning, heaven. Then I said, Swami, if that is so, this is Vaikuntha, Prashantinilayam. This is Vaikuntha. This is the paradise. This is the very heaven. He said, how do you know? I know because so long I am here, I am not worried. The moment I come out, worries chase me. Worries haunt me. The worryless state, the thoughtless state is paradise, the very heaven that I experience here. This is the paradise, I said. And then I said, Swami, what an ideal you have set before us, that we too have got to be free from our thoughts, free from our worries. What an ideal, adarsha. What an ideal you are, adarsha. Then Bhagavan said, it is not simple adarsham, ideal. It is my adesham, command to you. Adesham is command, while adarsha is ideal. This drives us home a point that Swami, the ideal adarsha, has adesha, the command behind it, for us to follow and emulate his example. And Swami said finally, that's why I say unto you that my life is my message. His life is ideal. His message is the command. Adarsha and Adesha. That's what he has said. Swami, somehow we get some kind of satisfaction You may call it psychological, by doing to the appreciation of others. When I do anything so as to win the admiration and appreciation of everybody, I have the satisfaction. Is it not? Santrupti, that is satisfaction. Swami said, Atma Santrupti, satisfaction of the self, is more important than the appreciation by others. Atma Santrupti, the self-satisfaction, is more important than the admiration or applause by any quarter from outside. With that, the 12th January 2003 conversation ends. Is that okay, please?
Yeah.
Could you follow these words?
Yeah.
That's fine.
Thank you.
Now, we go back to earlier numbers, as we have been doing all along. There are few words, four, used by Bhagavan. As usual that day, after the interviews, that evening he came out slowly, walking majestically, adjusting his hair in a beautiful style, which is inimitable, which is unique, and sat there nicely and started speaking to us. He just asked, "You had a meeting in the college today?" "Yes, Swami, we had a meeting this morning." "What was the topic?" "Swami, an expert spoke on globalization." "Oh, I see. Why globalization?" "Swami, globalization is very necessary to improve our standard of living." Bhagavan said, "You are wrong. Standard of living does not need to be improved. Therefore, globalization is not proper. It is the quality of life, it is the standard of life, which is much more important than the standard of living." That's what Bhagavan has said. Then he used two words. One word is what he said, pramana. Pramana meaning standard. Pramana. If you go by the standard of living, you will be met with pramada, danger. You will be met with danger if you go on by the standards. So, if not pramana, the standard, see that you don't face any pramada, the danger in life. That's what Bhagavan has said. Swami, we say that country is great. We say this country is rich because of its affluence, because of its plenty and prosperity. Does it not indicate per capita income of that country? Swami said, no. What is the national standard of life? The national standard of life is the integration of the entire organic world, of the entire beings, the animals, the plants, natural resources, integration of all these together constitute the national standards, not simply the externals. Then I could reflect upon myself from within. Today we have so many global problems. The greenhouse effect, the ozone holes, the pollution, all these problems are because of the lack of integration of natural resources. We kill the animal world, therefore the wildlife is suffering a lot. We kill or uproot all big trees, deforestation, and face the air pollution problem today. When Bhagavan says that integration of all the living beings, plants and animals and human beings, living together in perfect harmony, constitutes the standard of a nation. Not simply in terms of economy, not simply in terms of comforts, conveniences and luxury. That's how he has built that subject. Because these points have been bothering the environmental biologists, the ecologists all over the world. Then I said, Swami, if we don't make use of these all modern amenities, can I call myself a modern man? I think I'm modern, ultra-modern, by making use of all these natural resources. If I don't tap these natural resources, how can I be modern? Bhagavan said, no. Modernity is not exploitation. Modernity is limitation. Modernity is making use of natural resources in a limited way, without disfiguring it, without killing them altogether, without removing altogether. That's what modernity is, but that's what Bhagavan said. Swami, all right. Somehow, in this modern age, naturally, the standard of life will certainly go up. Yes. In earlier days, we did not make use of toothpaste and toothbrush. Long, long back. Modern man, toothpaste and toothbrush. Yes. The gas stoves and these things, heaters, they were not there in the earlier days. And people are making use of all these things today. The gadgets and all that. Don't you think so? So, naturally standard of life goes up with modernity, without any special effort. Then Baba said, we should note this point. Modern life, or what you call modernity, is not the latest style of living. The modernity lies in exercising feeling on our desires. Control of one's own desires is modernity, not a life of limitless desires. What a wonderful definition it is, which he only could give, which we can certainly emulate. Swami, it is nice to hear from you that we need to control our desires. Fine. How to do it? Please let me know. When I see you better off than me, well, I want to be much, much better than you. Don't you think so? How to control desires? I know I have to control, but how to control? I don't know. Then Bhagavan came liberally with a beautiful example. Don't get worried because the other man has a big building. Be happy that you have a shelter to live in. Don't get worried other man has a car. Be contented you have kallu, the legs. Car, kallu. Car, the legs. Be happy that you have got legs. You don't need to spend for petrol. And petrol hike, it doesn't bother you. Because God made tires. Kalu are with you. The legs, that's what Bhagavan has said. Swami, all right. Excuse me for this question. A luxury today may be a necessity tomorrow. Phone was a luxury. Today, it is a necessity. Refrigerator, a fridge, was a luxury. And today, a necessity. Swami, what do you say about it? As you know, Swami should be the last word. He would not budge even an inch on that score. Immediately said, did you not get along without phone earlier? Did you not live in those days? Were you not happy in those days without a phone? Were you not peaceful without a phone in those days? Why do you think that you cannot carry on without a phone? This is one of your own making. This is one of your own attachment. Why do you say like that? You had less of expenditure in those days and you were more comfortable. That's what he said. And actually speaking, you go to 5-star hotels, superstar hotels, is that necessary? Not necessary. To appease your hunger, to satiate your hunger, a simple meal is enough. Why extravagant meal? Why luxury? Is not necessary. That's what Bhagavan has said. Swami, all right. I want to see you. I want to talk to you. These are spiritual. Spiritual feelings also, are they desires? You said don't have desires. I want an interview, I want to have your darshan. Is that also a desire? Let me be very clear about it. Bhagavan said, no. All those spiritual are not desires. Why, Swami? Because you are involved, right? He said, no, no, no. Actually, what is a desire? A desire you developed to procure a thing or an object which you do not have, right? You don't have a car and you desire to have a car. You don't have a building, you desire to have a building, right? So, desire is that which is developed to possess or procure or acquire that you do not have now. Am I clear? But in spirituality, it is not procurement, it is not acquisition of anything that you do not have. It is only experiencing that what you are already. What you have got it already. Love. Love is not a desire. You are the embodiment of love. Peace. Peace is not a desire. You are the embodiment of peace. Truth. Truth is not a desire. You are embodiment of truth. God. God is not a desire. You are God. So how can that be desire? Then I thought, it is time not to rub too much on the wrong side. It seems to be quite an inconvenient area. And Swami started looking at me and said, do you have any desires now? What should I say? Then I said, Swami, I have no desires. Then I thought that you would compliment me. He didn't. You had sumptuous lunch with so many sweets and hearts, so you have no desire. You had a sumptuous, delicious meal. Well, I can understand. That's what he said. Here in this connection, he used these words which are of interest. One, mati, mind. Two, gati, progress. Three, sthiti, maintenance. Fourth, sampatti, attaining the six desirable qualifications. Or sampatti, your property. Four words. Mati, it is the mind that determines your gati, the goal. Am I clear? Third, and this gati, goal, has got to be sustained, has got to be maintained. That maintenance is sthiti. That is your property, what you call sampatti. Am I clear? So, gati, sthiti, mati, sampatti. These are the four words used in a sequential order by Bhagavan, which is a scientific development on the subject. As is the mind, mati, is your gati, destination. As is the gati, is your maintenance of your life, sthiti, which is your real property, sampatti. Am I clear? That's what he said in that context. But in this context he also said, it is most necessary for all of you to have an inward inquiry, nivritti. You are always outward, pravritti. Therefore you are not able to know the reality or the truth. That's what Bhagavan has said that day. And Swami also made a beautiful remark, which is very necessary for all of us right now. If you just correct yourself at an young age, the rest of the life is guaranteed. You are bound to be successful if you are disciplined and correct yourself at an young age. And if you follow my words, you are bound to be victorious. You are sure to be triumphant in life. That's what Bhagavan said. And then Swami also made a remark about a devotee. That devotee had full faith in me. He followed my command. Though the devotee suffered from his kidney problem, when I said, don't worry, you do not need it. And today, without having to undergo operation, is quite safe, secure, hale and healthy. Such similar experiences you will also have, provided you follow Swami's command. With that evening conversation ended. So we go to the next. That was the day when Swami was speaking about the hospital, the super speciality hospital, how many people have been saved, how children have been saved. And he was talking about his hospital to number of doctors from different places. How lives have been saved from total tragedy or catastrophe. How finances have been used liberally in such a hospital, most successfully. He was explaining to team of doctors who assembled there. Finally, I happened to be there and I said, Swami, though we are here, we do not know what all that is happening in our own hospital. I don't know how you are managing. Swami smiled and said, to do what you need is my duty. To ask me is your right. You can ask me that, you can demand, it is your right. And to do what you need is my duty, that's what Bhagavan has said. And then he told everybody, in our hospital, many, many boys are here, highly qualified. They are doing out of devotion, not for any financial gain. They are not doctors, but still, they are highly experienced. They know what it is, because it is their love for Swami that made them stay here. It was a kind of a revelation to many, many people who gathered there. It was another occasion when Bhagavan made few remarks which I want to share with you. Bhagavan started speaking that there is only God, none else. That it is only the divinity which is everywhere, nothing else. That all are his own reflections. Then I have put a question, Swami, why don't I know that then? If it is only divinity everywhere, nothing else, how is that I do not know? Then Swami said, your body attachment. Your body attachment is responsible for your ignorance, being not able to know your reality. Then I said, Swami, excuse me. This or this, glass or pen, they are lifeless. Whereas I have certain preferences. I love hot pickles. Glass has no preference. Pen has no preference. But you say everything is divine. Then what is the difference between me and the pen? Swami said, it is the mind. Your mind entertains preferences, but your spirit is choiceless. In fact, you love this glass, or you don't like this glass. Your likes and dislikes are yours, but this glass is one and the same. There is no change in the glass. So similarly, the divinity is one and the same. But your likes and dislikes are based on your mind, are based on your body attachment. Without them, the whole thing is divinity, which is beyond, without any duality, without any preferences. That's what Swami has said. Swami, is that all? Then why is it that I don't like everything? Swami said, there may be some mistake within you which may not help you to relish everything. Mistake in me? What mistake, Swami? Then he said, a diabetic patient cannot eat sweets. Because a diabetic patient does not eat sweets, it doesn't mean that something wrong with sweets. It is a mistake in the body of the sugar patient, not the mistake in the sweet. You can't blame the sweet, you have to blame the mistake in a diabetic patient, sugar patient. Am I clear? That's what Swami says. You are not able to enjoy gifts of God because of some mistakes within you. The mistakes within you will not help you to experience the divinity everywhere. That's what Bhagavan has said. Is that so, Swami? Then, why good and bad? Everything is divinity. Yes? Then why do you say that is good and this is bad? Is a good man and a bad man, good woman, bad woman? Why? Everything is divinity. Then Bhagavan said, there is nothing like good and bad. They exist together like positive and negative. Good and bad are based on the time. The food that you have eaten now is good. Next morning is bad, dirty matter. So what is good, what is bad now? 4 hours time. That's all. Oh, I say, Swami, I stand corrected. Then, Swami, if everything is divinity, if I know that, what is the benefit? What is the benefit? What is the advantage? If I don't know that everything is divinity, what is the harm? What is the loss? Then he said, no. Then once you know that everything is divine, you will have that spirit of equanimity or equal-mindedness. When there is equanimity, when there is equal-mindedness, you are blissful. Nothing on earth can shake you. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then, Swami said a beautiful example. When a child is born, you laugh and smile. When an old man dies, you cry. Child never said at the time of birth, come on, come on, laugh now. The old man never said, please cry after I die. They have not announced. It is only your attachment that made you smile and cry, that's all. Nothing is demanding. So, something goes wrong when you are not equanimous, when you are not blissful, when you are not aware of the consciousness or the divinity which is present everywhere. Swami, what is it that makes me separate from God? What is it that makes me feel separate from God? Then he said, God has uttama guna. Uttama, U-T-T-A-M-A. Uttama, noble. You have chatta guna, C-H-E-T-T-A, rotten. God has uttama, noble qualities. You have chatta, the rotten qualities. When once you get rid of this chatta, the rotten qualities, the latent, inherent, uttama, noble qualities will find a place. Then you will experience the divinity within. So it is time to know my limitations. I could understand. Swami, what is individual dharma? What is the community dharma? Are they one and the same? What is individual dharma? Dharma means code. Code of life. The conduct of life. The standard of life. What is individual dharma? Swami said, peace, forbearance, truth, compassion, sacrifice, these are the qualities. These are the components that constitute individual dharma or manava dharma or the code of a human being. Then Swami, what is community dharma? If peace is my dharma, is hatred dharma of the community? You follow my point? What is the difference between individual dharma and the societal dharma? Bhagavan said, see beautiful, please, it may look serious, but these points have not been dealt by everybody, please. We have gone through sufficient number of books. We also heard number of big people, their talks. But these subtleties have not been explained by anybody in such a lucid, simple, vivid style. I repeat once again, this is weakness of a teacher. I beg your pardon. I beg your pardon. What is the difference between the individual dharma and the societal dharma? It is doing its dharma. Swami said, the human values are the individual dharma. The community or the society dharma is to do that to others what exactly what you wanted to be done with. Do unto others as you would like to be done by. Do unto others as you would like to be done by. What all that is good to you is equally good to others. What all that hurts you will equally hurt others. What all that makes you happy will make others also happy. So, to conduct in that way, as you would like to be conducted towards yourself by others, is societal dharma. Am I clear? This is really good. Since this is not happening, we find so many differences among people. Then, I said, Swami, how nice it is to hear all these things from you. But we have been listening to you all the time, sitting. Most surprisingly, I find you standing. Excuse me, Swami, please be seated. He said, I am not tired. You may be feeling that I am troubling you. Is not trouble to me. I like to tell these things. I like to teach these things. This I like, that what Bhagavan has said. And Swami said, understand your true nature. If you understand your true self, the rest of the things will be known to you automatically. Since you don't understand yourself, you misunderstand others. Since you don't know your true nature, you will not be able to know anybody. That's what is happening today. So, that's what Bhagavan has said in this context. And I think we can wind up for today and we will continue next time. Thank you very much. Sai Narayana Narayana Satya Narayana Narayana Satya Narayana Narayana Sai Narayana Narayana Gana Lola Priya Narayana Gana Dina Pala Jaya Narayana Dina Pala Jaya Narayana Sai Narayana Narayana Sai Narayana Satya Narayana Narayana Sai Narayana Narayana Sai Narayana
గణగానలోల ప్రియ నారాయణ దీన పాల జయ నారాయణ దీన పాల జయ నారాయణ తాయి నారాయణ నారాయణ ఓ శాంతి శాంతి శాంతి
జయ బోలో భగవాన్ శ్రీ సత్సాయి బాబాజీకి జయ.